Morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everyone here.
Amen.
Yeah.
I feel every time I come home and I've been gone for a long time, I feel like the prodigal son. So I alerted everybody that I was on the road, and it's only fitting that God revealed to me, coming from 70-degree weather, to have snow. And I remember plowing snow all these times in New England. And I'm glad he's letting it continue to snow. A lot of people weren't driving in the blizzard, but I was enjoying myself in the blizzard on Wednesday. Amen. If you have any hymn books, because I don't know what songs you guys sing, but I'll go back to the old school, and then if a lot of it, I can go back to the new school, because there's a lot of new schools going on stuff. But as long as we're singing and making praise to the Lord, that's all that matters. Amen. Hymn number 432. I got to gauge you guys because a lot of you faces here. Amen? We'll sing the first and the fifth stanza because I know some of y'all want to get done. But I'll stay here all day because it's the Lord's day all day. Enough of that. To Canaan's land, I am on my way, where the soul of man never died. Oh, my darkest night. And Georgia, y'all still stomping on me. Come on now. That'll be a good welcome. This is the Lord's Day. I'm trying to find an old school new one. Where is it at? Old God's gonna change your hand. A lot of people have let go of God's hand in society today. You see that? 346, I just found it. Sacred selection never changes. That's the good thing. A lot of people change, but sacred selection will always be the same. 346. All right, y'all happy?
Yeah.
I still see some mean mothers over here. It could be because I'm down in Arkansas. But if truth be told, I was born and raised in New Haven. Yale New Haven Hospital, I was born. All right? I might not have went to Wilbur Cross or Hill House. I went to Amity High School, but my roots is still New Haven. I still can walk the streets of New Haven and have no fear. I can go to Bridgeport. I can go to Hartford. I can go to Stratford, Waterbury, wherever. I still get love because I was born and raised here. Amen? And I still get love because we all are covered in the blood. And that's all that matters. 346, time let us sing. Time is filled with swift transition. Oh, no. On earth unmoved. Come on, y'all. And build your hopes on things eternal. Oh, come on, church. Oh, 2,000 changing. Everybody ought to hold to his hand. 2,000 changing. And everybody ought to hold to his hand. Changing, and see that you build all your hopes on things eternal. Come on and hold to God's changing hand. Oh, trust in Him who will not leave you. Oh, whatsoever years may bring.
In rapture, so will you.
Hallelujah. Oh, I love praise. Church is singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, I love to praise his nectar, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, I love to praise his name. Oh, 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 I love to pray. Oh, 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 I love to pray. In the morning, I love to pray. In the nighttime, I love to pray. On Sunday, I love to praise his holy name.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen again. Amen. We thank Brother Phillips for stirring us up in those hymns of praise this morning.
Amen,
amen somebody. Amen. It might be snowing outside, but the sun ought to be shining in here. Amen. Amen. Because we still serve a God that's worthy to be praised.
Yes.
He woke us up this morning, started us on our way, clothed us in our right frame of mind. So we were able to navigate the dangerous highways to be able to come and worship him one more time. God is good all the time. And all the time, God is good. The psalmist still records in Psalm 34, verse number 1, I will bless the Lord at all times, even when it's snowing outside. All times. Even when I'm having a difficult time in life. All times. Even when your health might not be 100%. All times. When it's raining. All times. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. Verse number 3, the Bible says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. And in verse number 8, the Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Right.
Blessed is the man that trusts in him. He's better than camel soup, y'all. The God I serve, he's mighty, 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 mighty good. And we ought to give him all the praise, the glory, and honor in which he is due. I know it might have been tough this morning to navigate here, but you're here now. Well, since you're here, you might have given him all the praise you got up in you. Amen, somebody? I ought not have to shout at you to get you to praise God. When you just realize that all you had to do was just turn on the television. There were some folk who laid down on last night, didn't rise this morning. There were some folk who died. They were massacred. They were murdered. They went through some difficult circumstances. But God touched us with the finger of his love. Blessed us and brought us to this point, even in our day. And we just duty bound to give him all that is due. I woke up this morning with my mind, you know it was there. Oh, Jesus, you know I woke up this morning with my mind, you know it was there. Oh, the Lord, you know I woke up this morning with my mind, you know it was there. Oh, Jesus, we'll sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know I'm walking and talking with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Jesus. You know I'm walking and talking with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Lord. You know I'm walking and talking with my mind. You know it was there. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We are singing and praising with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Jesus, you know I'm singing and praising with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Lord, you know I'm singing and praising with my mind. You sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know I woke up this morning with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Jesus. You know I woke up this morning with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, the Lord. You know I woke up this morning with my mind. You know it was there. Oh, Jesus, we'll sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen, amen. Let us go to our Bibles, Acts the 8th chapter. Acts chapter 8, and we're going to begin at verse number 26. One more time, a familiar text for us. We're still continuing on with our theme regarding salvation. And church, I'm just excited again on last night. Some of you may have got the word, but we had another baptism on yesterday. We have a new sister in Christ. Her name is Sister Sharon Myrie. She wasn't able to make it out today due to the storm, but she has saw the forecast. We had a Bible study on Thursday night via webinar over the phone and internet. It was snowing on Thursday, didn't it? So as a result, we already had a Bible study scheduled. So I called Brother Watney. We put our heads together. I said, we got to find a way to communicate this message so she can see what I want to present. And we talked over the phone, and Sister Karen got on the phone, Sister Karen Warren, her and myself. But we studied for over an hour and a half. And she said, I don't want to get baptized today. I'm going to wait till Sunday. And I got a call around 12 o'clock yesterday afternoon. She said, I saw the forecast, and I don't want to put this thing off. She said, if we can do it today, I would much appreciate it. And saying somebody want to get baptized, they're just like saying sick to a bulldog. And we're going to make provision. Amen. Amen. So about 3 o'clock on yesterday, we had several saints that witnessed that. And we appreciate so very much her earnest to say, I don't want to put off obeying Jesus. I want to do it right now. Amen. And we all need to have that same kind of approach when it comes to being obedient to God. For those of you who are visiting with us, we just want to let you know you're indeed our honored guest. And we make no bones about it. Here at the New Haven Church of Christ, we want you to come back to be with us again, again, and again. And members of the body of Christ, we just expect to see you. Amen. Because God's been good to us. Yes. Acts chapter 8, beginning at verse number 26, the Bible reads, and the angel of the Lord spoke unto Philip, saying, arise, go toward the south, along the road which goes down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. So he arose and he went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge over all of her treasure and had come for Jerusalem, returning from worship. And he was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake, join yourself to this chariot, if you will. And verse number 30, the Bible says, so Philip ran to him, and he heard him reading the prophet Isaiah, and he asked him a question. He said, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I, except some man should guide me? And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him, and the place of the scripture which he read was this: he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb dumb before his shearer, he was silent. He opened not his mouth, and in his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare this generation, for his life is taken from the earth? Someone said, the eunuch answered Philip, and he said, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Is he talking about himself, or is he talking about another man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at that same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Now as they went down the road, they came to a certain body of water, and the eunuch said, see, there's water. What doth hinder me from being baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. And when they both came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. I want to lift the thought from the question that was posed in verse number 36. The eunuch asked the question, what's hindering me from being baptized? I want to speak to you this morning from the subject, what's holding you back from being saved? What's holding you back from being saved? And we'll look at three items this morning. We're going to try to do it expeditiously due to the weather outside. We're going to see his concern, his confusion, and his conversion. His concern, his confusion, and his conversion. What's holding you back from being saved? God bless you. God bless you. This morning we have one of the accounts of conversion that is used in gospel meetings throughout the nation and the world, if you will. This is a very familiar text. If you're definitely a member of the Church of Christ, if you will. But this is one that's plain. And let me tell you something. In order to obey Jesus, you have to have an honest heart. And that's one of the things that I appreciate about the eunuch as we're going to begin to peruse this text and begin to see that he had an earnest heart. And we have to have an open and an honest heart in order to receive Jesus. We have to have an open and an honest heart to continue to follow Jesus. Amen. Now in the text, the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord had said to Philip. Philip had just got finished preaching in parts of Samaria. At the beginning of the text, in chapter 8, we find that there's great persecution that the church is facing. The Bible tells us in chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, that the apostle that Saul at the time, before he became the apostle Paul, he was wreaking havoc on the church. And as a result, there were many who believed in Christ. They were scattered abroad. But the good thing is, in the event that they were scattered as a result of the persecution, they began preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then even prior to this, we have an encounter where Philip, he runs into Simon, the sorcerer, who came to ultimately obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. But now he has been commissioned yet again by the Spirit. He said, look, there's a man from Ethiopia who is coming back from Jerusalem from worshiping. And I want you to join yourself to the chariot. And there are some things that we need to understand regarding the text. The eunuch was known as a man of Ethiopia. Gaza was near the confines between Palestine and Egypt. It was the direct road from Jerusalem to Egypt. And Ethiopia was one of the great kingdoms in Africa. He was a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all of her treasure. And in today's vernacular, he would have been the CFO of the organization. Candace, we have to understand, that was not her name. Candace was a title, just like Pharaoh was a title, like Herod was a title. And in our common day, like the Mr. President, that's a title, that's not his name. But Candace was the title of the queen mother who governed their nation. The eunuch was a man of great authority. He was the minister of finance. He had great authority over all her treasure. He was somebody in Ethiopia, y'all. He had power. He had respect. He had prestige. He had influence. He must have been thoroughly equipped, intellectually astute, and morally accountable and trustworthy to be able to handle the treasury for the queen. He could not become a full Jew. A eunuch was one who, a male who was considered to be castrated. And there were three types of eunuchs that we'll look at. But one of the dynamics was, the Bible said that he came from Jerusalem for to worship. He was given over to Judaism. He couldn't be a full-fledged Jew because he wasn't born a Jew. But there were many who converted to Judaism. They were considered to be proselytes. He could not become a full Jewish proselyte because he had a problem. He was a eunuch. And the Old Testament law prevented him from gaining access to the Lord. He could worship, but he could not come near. He can go to the point of the temple, but he couldn't go inside. He said, my dude, I never heard that before. Well, the Bible outlines some things. In Deuteronomy 23 and verse number 1, the Bible said, he that is wounded with stones and has his privacy member cut off shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. His physical condition prevented him from entering the congregation of the Lord. There were those who had koinonia fellowship one with another, but he would have to sit on the outside of the temple because he wasn't considered worthy to go in. And he would have to hear inside what he could hear regarding what was being read. This man had a devotion and he wanted to get closer to God. The eunuch had been to church, but he was still cut off from the fellowship. He had a problem he could not overcome. There was nothing he could do to change his condition. There were three types of eunuchs. There were those eunuchs which were born from their mother's womb, and there were eunuchs which were made eunuchs of men, and there were eunuchs who have been made eunuchs themselves for the kingdom's sake. And one of the things you have to understand, those who were castrated, many times they would guard the queen in a particular, and her harem, and the king didn't really have to worry about too much because he was a eunuch, if you will. But he was also known as a trusted confidant, if you will. That is able. And one of the things we have to understand, that it's important to come to God the way we are, broken, burdened, and begging. This man, he knew that he couldn't be a full-fledged Jew, but he wanted some of God anyway. But then, oh, we're glad that this Philip, the man of God, he ran into the eunuch, and they began to dialogue and have a conversation. And this man was committed to attending the great Jewish feast, and the text tells us that he came for Jerusalem for worshiping. Isn't it exciting, church, that a man who's excited about going to worship? Amen, somebody? They indicated this man had to travel some 300 miles just to go sit on the outskirts of the church building. He couldn't go inside, but he had to travel some 300 miles just to hear earshot, to be in the vicinity to hear what God had to say. Yet he was close, but yet he was still so far off. Thank God for Jesus. And if we're not careful, look, let me tell you something. You can be right in the house of God and still not be close to God. You can be all around salvation and yet still be saved. He said, preacher, I come to church with my mama. Preacher, I come to church with my granddaddy. Preacher, I go to church with so-and-so. See, granddaddy might be saved. Mama might be saved. But the question is, are you saved? He said, preacher, I might come with my wife. That's all right for your wife. But the question is, are you saved? And we come to find out as we begin to peruse this text that there was something, there were some things that was hindering. He asked, what's hindering for me being baptized? This man, he was purpose driven, and one of the things in the text that we may not find out concerning about worship, but he was reading the scriptures. Amen. It's good to read the scriptures outside the service. Amen. Somebody. He'd already came from worship, but he still wanted to know more about God. We know this man, he had to have some affluence because he had his own personal copy of a portion of one of the prophets, which was Isaiah, that he was reading. Let me tell you something. At that particular time, you have to have some moolah. You have to have some green. You have to have some cash in order to be able to have your own personal copy of one of the manuscripts of God's word. But the Bible indicated that this man, he was sitting in his Mercedes-Benz truck. Yeah, he was sitting there just chilling there. And the Bible said he was reading God's word. That's when Philip rolled upon him. And let me tell you something. Men ought to be concerned about their soul's salvation. The Apostle Paul says that it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. The Bible says in Luke verse number 19 and verse number 10, Jesus, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And if we go back to our theme and our mission of the church, is to seek the lost, to strengthen the saved. And we're going to do it all by standing on the word of God. Part of our mission and part of our focus has to be to seek those that don't know God, strengthen those that do know God. And we're going to do it all by standing on the word of God. This man's commitment to know more about God led him to his own salvation. But he was confused. The Bible indicates that as he was reading, and then Philip, he made his way to the chariot, and Philip asked this man a poignant question. He says, do you understand what you're reading? Yeah. Amen. I'll stop by to tell you, that's a good question. I hear people all the time, well, preacher, I read my Bible every day. Let me tell you something. I know I studied this book for a living. Now, there's some things you can read and not have understanding. Amen, somebody? See, you might read every day, but do you understand every day? See, a cursory reading of the Bible might not give you the original intent or the author's intent. But see, the man of God, he asked him the question. And can you imagine, he's riding up. He see this nice ride. And look, the preacher man, he wasn't put off by what he saw. And see, you got to understand the CEO, look, over the treasury of the queen, he traveled in an entourage. Amen, somebody? Amen. Let me tell you something. They would put something down on the ground before his feet would actually touch the ground. This man was royalty, if you will. He was in the king and the queen's court. And Philip, I can see Philip, the preacher man, he's making his way, maybe in some ill-equipped sandals, up to where this man is, and then he peeks in on him. He says, "Sir, do you understand what it is that you read?" But notice, the Bible indicates that this eunuch, he was an honest man. Because he then begins to say, he said, "How can I accept some man should guide me?" Can you imagine how some of you already responded? Who do you think you are? Do you know who I am? Do you not see the entourage outside of this area? Do you not see the wheels that I'm riding in? Yeah. Not some of y'all. Not y'all. I'm sorry. I was thinking about the wrong kind of thing. Y'all wouldn't have responded like that. Y'all would have been honest just like the eunuch was honest. Huh? Philip asked a high-ranking official an intriguing and in some estimation an absurd question. "Sir, do you understand what you're reading?" Now, I already know some of us would have been all tore up if someone had asked us that question. And we're saying, "Look, well, what gives you the intestinal fortitude, the unmitigated gall to even part your lips to ask me a question like that? Don't I look like I know what I'm doing? Don't I look like, if I'm sitting here reading, don't you think that I have the intellect to be able to understand what I'm reading?" But this man was honest. He said, "Man, you know, there's some things that I know about finance and accounting and things of that nature, but when it comes to this, look, I'm a little confused regarding you." And the Bible indicates that he was reading a portion of the scripture. And the Bible says in verse number 31, and he said, "How can I accept somebody should guide me?" And Philip asked him to come up to be with him. In the place of the scripture in which he read, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter. He was like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so he opened not his mouth. And what he was doing, he was actually reading parts of Isaiah chapter 53. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 53. We're going to give you a little more bird's eye view to who it was that the eunuch was reading about. Isaiah chapter 53, and we're going to begin at verse number 1. Y'all got your Bibles? God's still good? All right. Isaiah 53, verse number 1, the Bible said, "Who has believed our report? And to whom is the Lord, the arm of the Lord revealed? But he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or no comeliness about him that we should desire to see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him." In verse number 3, the Bible says, "He was despised. He was rejected by men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid our faces from him, and he was despised, and we did not esteem him." They're talking about Jesus, y'all. "Surely he has borne our griefs. He's carried our sorrow." Are you listening to what your Savior did for you? "He borne our griefs and he carried our sorrows. And yet we esteemed him smitten and stricken of God and afflicted. But he was wounded." Why was he wounded? "For our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities," or our wickedness. "The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, you and I receive healing." "Oh, we like sheep, we have gone astray, and we've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid the iniquity of all of us on him." He was oppressed, y'all. He was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers, he was silent. He didn't open his mouth. He was taken from prison to judgment. And the Bible said, "Who should declare this generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, he was stricken." Do you understand? He's talking about the nature and the person of Jesus Christ. He said, "Let me tell you something. You see how God made him?" The Bible says that there was no comeliness about him that we should even desire him. They said, out of a crowd, you couldn't tell Jesus was the Son of God. They say, "Look, there was no particular beauty about him that you would say, I can tell, that's the one." They said that, that there was no desire, look, that we should even desire him. Are y'all hearing this thing? He was despised by men. He was rejected by men. Let me tell you something, he's still being rejected today. And sometimes, yeah, even when I realize that he's borne our griefs and by his stripes we are healed, look, you and I wouldn't have a chance to the tree of life separate and apart for Jesus being hung up for our hang-ups. The Bible said, he who knew no sin became sin for you and for me. And every now and again, we've got to be reminded that he suffered not for his behalf, he suffered on our behalf. His death was vicarious. He did it for another person. The Bible indicates that no man taketh my life from me, but Jesus said, I lay it down. And as this man was reading, and we go back to Acts chapter 8, this is the portion of the text, and he gives them the idea. He said, what's this concept about him being led as a sheep to the slaughter? You remember when they came to take Jesus? And you remember Peter before they got a hold of Jesus, that Peter cut Malchus's ear off? Huh? Put your switchblade away. Jesus said, Peter, we're not going to do it this way. You live by the sword, you die by the sword. I got to allow them to be able to do this. I got to go this way. And when they capture him, and then Pilate say, look, man, do you not understand what they accuse you of? Look, I find no fault with this man. He said, but look, this is serious stuff. You can die for this, and you don't have anything to say for yourself? They say you're the Son of God. Are you? And Jesus said, so you say. Do you not understand what the charges are? Yeah. Pilate saying to Jesus, do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth? But Jesus knew he could have defended himself. He's a lawyer that's never lost the case. But if he didn't go that way, you and I wouldn't have a chance to the tree of life. You and I wouldn't have a chance to eternal life. And this man, Jesus, that's who Philip began talking to the eunuch about. The Bible said that he began at that same scripture. He said, man, let me tell you about a man named Jesus. And let me tell you what he was willing to do. Look, for the downtrodden, for the outcast, for the rejected. Look, for the vile. Let me tell you, the Bible says in Romans chapter 5 and verse number 6, for when we were yet without strength, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. In verse number 8, the Bible said, but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something, the Savior I know, let me tell you, he died for us, not when we were at our best, but he died for us when we were at our worst. Amen, somebody, when you think about somebody dying in my place, it was me who deserved the cross. But because of his love for you and for me, he said, God, I'll stand in their place. Are you kidding me? Are you hearing this thing? Man, somebody who was willing to take a beating for me, who was beat till his flesh hung open, who was spit on, who was reviled, who was mocked, who was scorned. All for me. Let me tell you something. When you realize what God's done for you,
yeah,
man, can't nobody hold your praise.
Amen,
amen, somebody? Amen. Man, see, when I realize how good God's been, can't nobody run me out of this church.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? He said, well, somebody ain't speak to me today. I'm just going to pray for him. I'm going to keep on moving. Amen, somebody? Because God's been good. I ain't going to have nobody talk me out of my worship. Let me see. See, worship, look, when you think about the death thing, it has to do with God's worship. He's worth it. Amen, somebody? Based on what he's done. What he's delivered me from. What he's delivered you from. There were some folk who counted you out, but God counted you in. And that's the only way that you're here right now. Because God, he stood for me when I couldn't stand for myself. Are you hearing this thing?
Yeah.
Amen. When I think about that, in the midst of my tiredness, in the midst of my frustration, you said, look, I got to get my tie on. Let me get my suit together. And let me get down to the house of the Lord because he's worthy to be praised.
Yeah.
You said, I don't feel like singing today. But when I begin to remember about Isaiah chapter 53, he was bruised.
Yeah.
Look, for me, he was beat. For me, he was rejected. For me, he was despised. For me, he was, look, nobody desired him. Look, there was no comeliness about him, but he did it all for me. And because he did it for me, I'm going to use all the energy I got to praise him. I'm going to use all the energy I got to serve him. I'm going to model the best Christian behavior that I can because I realize he just didn't do it for him. He did it for me. And because I realize he did it for me. Oh, man, there's no such thing. Church is too long. Huh? See, you just don't realize he did it for you. There's no such thing. We singing too many songs. You just don't realize he did it for you. You said that it's just too much church. There's too many programs. You just don't realize he did it for you. And see, well, let me tell you something about our God. He's not just doing it for you. He's doing it for your children. He's doing it for your grandchildren. He's doing it for your parents that's still here. God is not just doing it for you. He's doing it for everybody that's connected to you. Oh, I'm telling you about a mighty God we serve. And he ought to get all the praise that you have within you. One of the things I appreciate about the unit, and that he was an honor seeker, he could have allowed his pride to get in the way. But he wanted to know more about the will of God. He was confused. And then he began with the same scripture in the Bible. Says he preached unto him Jesus. And this is a powerful point here. Let me tell you something. The next thing that we point to, the Bible says, as they were traveling in the chariot, in the Lexus, in the Mercedes, as they were traveling, y'all see this thing? As they were traveling, he saw some water. Remember, they were in the desert.
Right.
I stopped by to tell you, God, he's able to make a way out of no way. He's always able to make a way for you to serve him. He's always able to make a way for you to obey him.
Yeah.
While they were traveling, he said, man, I see some water over there. What's stopping me? What would hinder me? What would prevent me from being baptized?
Yeah.
And I stopped by to tell you today, you can't preach Jesus without preaching baptism.
That's right.
Oh, I think I said something. You can't preach Jesus without preaching baptism because Jesus and baptism go together like macaroni and cheese and bacon and eggs. Amen, somebody. Peanut butter and jelly. Jesus and baptism go together. Because when Jesus gave the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28 and verse number 18 through 20, he said, go into all the world, teach all nations, baptizing them. Y'all hear it? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you. He said, and if you do this, I'll be with you always, even until the end of the world. That's what Matthew said, according to what Jesus said. Mark said something similar. He said, Mark chapter 16 and verse number 15, he said, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be condemned. You got to understand, Jesus told the apostles to teach, baptize, and teach. And guess what? They taught, and they baptized, and they taught. Mm-hmm. Here is another one of God's men, Philip. And the Bible said after they preached unto him, Jesus, after riding in the chariot, I stopped by to tell you, he wasn't so sedentary. He didn't say, I got to check with the queen first. He didn't say, I need to check with my girlfriend. He didn't say, I need to check with grandma. He didn't say, he said, there's a water right over there. What's stopping me from being baptized? And then the Bible says, Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And then somebody said, and the driver, I don't know if he hit him in the back of the head with a rock. He said, stop the chariot. So as they were driving, I could see them. That's the water over there. He said, I believe. And let me tell you something, your belief should always move you to do something.
Yeah.
Your belief ought to move you to obey God. Yeah. Let me tell you something, I don't want people, don't talk me today. I love the Lord, I love the Lord, I love the Lord. Let me tell you something, Jesus said, if you love me, John 14, 15, keep my commandments. If you love them, show it through your servants. If you love them, show it in your smile. If you love them, allow us to see the fruits of the Spirit working in your life. Amen, somebody? Not just come to church, you and I ought to be the church. The Bible said he preached unto him Jesus. He stopped the chariot. The Bible said they both, Philip and the eunuch, got out and they both went down into the water. And Philip baptized him. The Bible said they both came up out of the water because baptism again is a burial. Amen, somebody? It's not a sprinkling. You won't find that in the Bible. Baptism comes from the Greek word baptizo, which means to be dipped, plunged, or immersed. In Romans chapter 6 and verse number 1, the Bible says, if we continue in sin, that grace may abound. God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? The Bible says we are buried with him by baptism. Amen, somebody? Into his death. He said, the Bible indicates to us, he said, we're buried with him by baptism. He said, let me tell you something. He said, just like Christ was raised from the glory of the Father, so should we. We ought to be raised to walk in the newness of life. What happens in baptism? Look, God washes away my sins. He said, preacher, where do you find it? Acts chapter 22 and verse number 16, Ananias told Paul, arise, be baptized, washing away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. You and I, what I've come to realize, we haven't always been good girls and good boys. We've done some wrong things. We've been some wrong places. We've thought some wrong thoughts. Amen, somebody, come along with me here. I'll stay here a little bit longer. Yeah, we've done some things that we ought not have done. And we got some shame about some stuff that we shouldn't have done. That's some stuff you've done you ain't even told your best friend. Let alone your mama. Mama still think you're pure. Lord, have mercy. Look, you can have a man that's facing 400 murders. And mama said he's still a good boy. Yeah, let me tell you, you might be able to get it over on mama, but God even sees the secret things. Amen, somebody? And you ain't told your best friend because they're going to look at you and say, what? But no, God knows the secret things. But see, baptism, let me tell you something, that places you into Christ. God washes away your sins. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse number 38, Peter, when they asked him the question in verse number 37, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. No baptism, no Holy Spirit. No baptism, no forgiveness of your sin. No baptism, no added to the church of Christ. But let me tell you something. If you want to be what God calls us to be, you got to do it his way. And Philip could have said something different. But let me tell you something. Just like I told you before, you can't preach Jesus without preaching baptism. He said, man, since you're talking about Isaiah 53, and that text is all about Jesus up and down. So I can't preach Jesus without preaching baptism. So the Bible says that as they saw the water, they stopped the chariot. Philip and the eunuch, both, I said, they both went down into the water. And they both came up out of the water. And I want to remind you today that there is salvation in no other name than Jesus Christ. Jesus destroyed the works of the devil. Jesus broke down the middle wall of partition. Jesus took the handwriting of ordinance away. Jesus formed the principalities of power. Jesus is the head of the body of the church. Jesus is the savior of the body. Jesus is the faithful witness. He's the first begotten of the dead. He's the prince of the kings of the earth. Jesus loves us. He loves you and he loves me. Jesus washed us with his own blood. He's put all things under his feet. He took victory from the grave. He took the sting out of death. He brought grace and through Jesus still the storms. He gave water when the wine ran out. Jesus gave sight to the blind. He evicted some demons from the possessed man. Jesus fed the famished. And if he was able to do all that, he's able to save you of your soul today. But the question on the floor this morning, what's hindering you? What's getting in your way? You say, well, you know, preacher, I would come to God, but you know, I'm only 15. You know, I'm going to start serving the Lord, you know, when I get about 25. And then when you get 25, you push it out to 35. Then when you get 35, you say, I do it when I'm about 50. And then when you get 50, you say, well, I do it about 65, about retirement time, about Social Security. You say, I'll start coming in when all your energy gone and you've done everything you want. Don't do God like that. Amen, somebody? Bible says Ecclesiastes chapter 12, remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth before the evil days come now. You got to serve God when you got your vigor and your vitality. You can do more in the kingdom that way. Don't use yourself up in the world and giving your time and talent to the world and you come give God some scraps.
All right.
Amen. Somebody said, brother, I'm just so tired. I know things need to be done. I know the community need to be served. I know folk need to be taught. I know, but you know I'm tired, don't you? Let me tell you something. The only way you still tired is because God's been good to you. He smiled on you. He touched you with a finger of his love. He's more gracious to us than we are to ourselves. Don't forget about the blessings of the Lord. What's hindering you? You said, well, you know, if I come to God, then that might mean I might have to let the old lady go. You know. Somebody said it for me. Y'all would have thought it was harsh, but y'all heard it come from the audience. But let me tell you something. Jesus is more important. Amen? What should a man give in exchange for his soul? He said, well, you know, I'm working on this ground. I'm trying to climb the corporate ladder. Let me tell you something. You can still climb it with Jesus. Amen, somebody? Amen, somebody? Because you climb it on your own and you got getting wrong in the wrong backdoor deal, you've been going to jail in a corruption scandal, trying to climb without Jesus. You need the Lord to be successful. He said, brother, I got problems. Man, I got this going on. Man, I got that going on. Man, I got this. That's why you need God. God knew before he created you, you were going to need him. He's just waiting till you get to the point to realize it. Huh? You get out there, life start getting hard. I remember 18, I can't wait to get out of my home. I'm tired of all these rules around here. Then I had to start paying for stuff myself. There were so many days I just wanted to call back home, brother, oh, grandma, can I come back? But my pride wouldn't let me. She probably wouldn't let me come. Praise the name of Jesus. Huh? Got soap, you need God. You taking on a wife, you need God. Raising some children, you need God. You say, oh, I'm just in high school. You got peer pressure, though. You need God. In every facet of your living, you need God. And so you come to know God by hearing the gospel message, believing the same, repenting of your sins, confessing your faith in Christ. The eunuchs, I believe that. Well, he said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Make the same confession you made, and we'll baptize you today. Just like that precious soul who had some foresight and said that weather might be bad. And I don't want to put it off because I don't know what tomorrow holds. See, I don't know what tomorrow holds, but see, I know who holds tomorrow. See, as long as I'm in good with the one who holds tomorrow, I'm going to be all right. I'm going to be all right. You want to be all right? See, you can't be all right without Jesus. You can't be all right continuing to do things your own way. See, the eunuch, he's an example of somebody, man, let me tell you something, intellectually astute. He had all the finance degrees, had the accounting background, and this man was large and in charge. But we see humility in his lifestyle. But guess what the preacher told him? The preacher ain't had the ride that he had. But the preacher man told him, you need God. You need Jesus. See, I know you're traveling 300 miles to worship in Jerusalem, but you can't even go inside. You're not connected. But see, Jesus knows how to minister to the rejected folk. He know what it's like to be rejected. He know what it's like for people to say, I'm for you, and then turn their back on you and walk away. He know what it's like. Let me tell you something. We serve a Savior who can identify with your struggle. He said, brother, you don't understand. They promised me, and they said they would never, and they walked away. Jesus knows about it. He know what it's like to be rejected. He know what it's like to be mistreated. He know what it's like to be talked about. You're not the only one. You got a Savior that can identify. You know what God, he said, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. And the Bible said, and he will lift you up. He said, when they tear you down, you got me. See, people want you to think you're alone. But as long as you got God, you might be lonely sometime, but you're never alone. That's good news today. That's good news today. You might be alone, but you're never alone. You know the song, No, Never Alone? Yeah. Amen, somebody? Amen. He promised never to leave me. Never to leave me alone. Amen. And see, if you want that promise that he has to offer, you got to obey him today. Don't put off baptism when you know that that's what God is calling you to do. And you can't cry foul when things go sideways in your life. And guess what? For the Christian and the non-Christian, difficult things going to happen. People going to pass away. Their jobs is going to be lost. Problems with your kids. There'll be problems in your marriage. But let me tell you something. As long as you got Jesus, you got a chance and a hope of making it through. Amen, amen, somebody? Amen. Amen. It's like, everything might not be. At least I got Jesus. He's hope for tomorrow. Amen, somebody? Amen. So that's why I'm not enamored by everything that's going on in the political world. See, I got Jesus. Right. See, ain't nothing going to happen without God say so. Right. Amen, somebody? He said, well, what are we going to do? Keep on serving him like I've been. Amen, somebody? Because he gets gooder and gooder. I'm sorry. Yeah. Well, he's gooder than me. Huh? He's the bestest. There's none greater. Man, that ought to give you comfort in serving than with somebody who there's no greater than him.
That's right.
Amen, somebody? Amen. There's no job that ought to get all your priority over God.
That's right.
Amen? Because God's the one who supplies whatever it is.
Yes.
He's the source of blessing. You're a member of the body of Jesus Christ. You've allowed some other things to hinder you. Not from just being saved, but for serving in the capacity of giving your all to Jesus. God wants all. Serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, with all thy soul, with all thy strength. God wants all of you. He don't want parts of you. He don't want second place. Let me tell you something. Second place is no place to God. He said, well, second kind of hot. He want kind of first. Amen, somebody?
Right.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. We serve a God. Let me tell you something. He put it all on the line for us. And he requires the same thing from us, from you and from me. We're about to stand and sing the same invitation. And we bid you to come as we stand and sing. Come on to Jesus today. Is there somebody who wants to be saved? Come on right now. Come on.
Just
right
as I am.
Somebody need prayer.
Without one.
Don't let anybody hinder you. Come on.